All right. Good afternoon. Welcome to our December PartnerCast. Thanks for joining us today. And as you can kind of tell, we're talking about immersive experiences today that can be created with many of the technologies that we offer here at Barco. And we do have a special guest that'll be joining us in just a moment, but we're excited about PartnerCast. This is a monthly review of various topics that are really focused on our partner community throughout the Americas. And I'm very happy that you've all joined us today and taken a little time out of your schedules. Throughout the session today, please feel free to use the Q&A function in WebEx. You can see the little icon there. Look for that and type in some questions into the chat box, and we'll address those at the end of today's session. Also, let's get connected on LinkedIn. You can take your mobile phone and scan the QR code on the screen right now, or just look me up on LinkedIn. But love to get connected with all of our partners through LinkedIn. And I'm always trying to share all things that are, you know, shared from Barco out to our partner community via the LinkedIn platform. And that's a great way to keep up to date with all the things that we're doing here at Barco. And last but not least, if you ever have any questions and can't remember my name or anyone else at Barco, you can always remember us.connect@barco.com. And that goes right into our sales operations group, and they will find the right person to address any question that you may have, whether it's about our dealer programs, whether it's about our products, or whether it's about a technical issue that you need some help with. So don't forget us.connect@barco.com. Now, PartnerCast is always built into three different segments. The first is, someone's chatted in here. They didn't have any sound, but I think everything seems to be working on my side. It's always broken into three different segments: business alignment, product alignment, and strategy alignment. So let's get into our topics for today's session. First, on the business alignment side, we're going to talk about tapping into our sales engineering resources to design and build solutions using Barco technologies. Second, we're going to talk a lot about immersive projection applications and experiences, and how we can help our integration partners build, you know, incredible experiences for their customers. And last but not least, one of the things that we get asked the most is, which lens should I be using for my projection design, or my throw distance, or my screen sizes? I spoke with our help desk earlier in the week, and they said that this was one of the top questions that they get from our integration partners. So I thought we'd get through a little bit of information on things that we have on our website that are active and accessible today to help you with that. So first topic, let's talk about sales engineering. So, you know, in a lot of cases, our integration partners are selling products and technologies from a number of different companies. Obviously, you're not just positioning Barco, although we would love you to do that, but we know that that's not practical or reasonable to request. But we also have, you know, very unique applications and elements of our product solution that may be very different from some of the other vendors in our spaces. So we do have this fantastic sales engineering and pre-sales engineering resources available for our partners, and they can help with anything from configurations and consulting, helping you build the appropriate quote or doing some quote reviews to make sure that the system that you've designed will deliver the experience that your customer is asking for. They're always available for on-site customer demos if you're looking for any product to actually be shown physically on-site at a customer location. Our pre-sales engineering team can help with that. And then any other questions that may pop up that we may get around, you know, do you have this feature? How do I do managed services using, you know, one of our products? You know, when is the next software release coming up? Or what should I upgrade the firmware in my device with this new firmware that's been released? All of those relevant questions are what this team is available for our partners to answer and address those questions for you. So, you know, we have, these guys are located around the country, okay? Our team lead here is Dak Patrick. You can see the direct email to any of these gentlemen that are on our team. And you'll also see some some very specialty areas that they focus on. So, for example, within our projection portfolio, Michael Pritchard, Khaled Shakur, and Robert Joseph are our team leads, and they also help quite a bit with some other specialty applications like simulation, LED, and image processing. And if we're going through today's information, and you'll see some information specific on image processing, you'll see another name there on the screen, Vincent Ayala. He's one of our specialists on the image processing platforms. But then all of our products are covered by one of these individuals as a specialty. And always you can get to our tech support team through the number that's on the screen, as well as our web address that's listed there. And Michael Dunn is our technical services manager. So he handles everything post-sale, or he is the supervisor for all things post-sale, and can certainly help you with any questions that you may have after the sale has been made. So pre and post available for our partners. Now, the other item that the other service that we also offer at Barco that is that's not as well known as some of the others is project management. So many of the projects or project types that we're going to be talking about today really are end to end projects that need to be managed. So lead times, installation schedules, et cetera, all of those things. We have resources within our company in our headquarters in Atlanta. And our project management office is available for all of our partners to really, you know, get behind that project and make sure that it gets delivered on time, on budget, and right the first time. So don't pass this by. This is a valuable resource for our partners and something that will make your life significantly easier in the future. So, you know, tap into the resources that are available. We have too few partners that are tapping into these resources on a regular basis. And these are free services that we offer out to our partners, and we want to make sure that you're taking advantage of all of the resources available for our Connect partners throughout the Americas region. Now, as we get into our main topic, I want to introduce my colleague and friend Richard Marples. And Richard, if you put your picture up on the screen, but please turn on your camera so the folks out there can interact with you during today's session. So Richard has been in the industry for a number of years, over 17 years experience in the projection market specifically. He is our director of sales enablement, and that's really helping our partners and helping our team excel in the projection industry and market. And Richard is based in our headquarters in Belgium. So welcome today, Richard, and thanks for joining.
It's nice to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me. I hope you can hear me well.
Yeah, good to see you. And you're actually based in you're based in Brussels downtown. And so how is COVID in Belgium today? So share a little context about Europe with us.
The numbers are not good. Belgium took the unlikely first spot for the number of deaths, I think, per population worldwide. So we have that honor still, I think, at the moment. I'm not sure what the current table is. But things have been locked down now for quite a while. They still are, and they're going to be locked down as well until we get into the new year. That means that bars, restaurants, cafes are all closed. Hairdressers are not closed, so hence my hair's getting a bit long. We're not allowed to go to the hairdressers. Shops are open. We have to walk around with a mask on. We're not allowed to travel around too much, but it's not too bad. It could be worse.
Good. Well, stay safe there. And we're facing a lot of the same things here in the US. To get right to our topic, we're really talking about immersive experiences. And we've done something interesting at Barco, right? We've created a whole team that's really focused on this experiential immersive experience area. And so what does that mean to our integration partners? Like, why should they care about this?
That's right. Well, you know that at Barco, we've got a couple of main divisions. And one of those divisions is entertainment. And within entertainment, a couple of main businesses. One of them, of course, is cinema. So they look after the cinema part of the business worldwide. Another one is simulation. So very specialized. They look after the simulation projects around the world. And then the other one, which is the one that I work for, is what we call IX, or immersive experiences. And that combines both the events business, rental and staging, and also the themed entertainment and specialist visualization businesses. And our whole mission is really about creating immersive experiences, whether they're on a temporary basis with the events partners, or whether they're in fixed installs with our fixed installation partners. And we aim to do that by offering the main products at our disposal, so those being projectors and image processing mainly, although we can call upon the other products of Barco as well, should they be needed. And essentially, we want to create wow. If we can create wow moments for our customers, that means that those visitors, those guests, whoever it is that may be seeing it, maybe we'll want to come back and repeat their business, come back and see us again, buy some more stuff. So that helps the business. And whether we do that live on the premise, or whether we do it virtually more and more these days as well, we get called to do more and more virtual things. That's really what the whole business is about.
Well, that's awesome. And this is a kind of a new innovation, or a new way of organizing our internal teams. It doesn't really have much impact on our customer facing teams or our sales organizations globally. But what this does give us is ready access to individuals that have a high level of expertise in these particular, you know, segments of the market. Right. So we've got individuals that are going to help you with virtual reality, for example, or a simulation application, or a very large projection mapping project. You know, how this really helps us align at those specialty groups or those use cases and make those resources available for our partners, which I think is a really good way of us looking at the industry and trying to match our business approach to our partners and do as much enablement of those partners as we possibly can. Now, in this kind of IX grouping, I know we've done some studies or like some work around the use cases that are most applicable that we're really focused on. And we've broken these out into these five different segments. So can you kind of, and then we've got some letters down at the bottom, you know, that relate to kind of the appropriate product that potentially kind of fits in that market. So take us through this, how we look at our space in the immersive experience business.
Yeah, sure. So these are our main markets that we sort of try to concentrate on. Of course, there will always be others. We may be able to sell a projector or an image processing box, you know, to all kinds of different installations, but these are sort of the main buckets. So as I mentioned, events, rental and staging. This is a big bucket for us, quite a traditional one that Barco is well known for. It's where we sort of made a lot of the developments and R&D that went into the projectors as you know them today came from this events industry. Of course, currently it's particularly badly hit by the pandemic that's going around the world. Many of these events are stopped currently, and a lot of our events partners are really suffering. So it's not an easy time. But still, the hope is that events will come back when we get these vaccines out and people can start meeting again. We can start having events, and the events business will take off again. I think the need for human beings to get together and interact and meet with each other and exchange ideas, I think, you know, will win over in the end. So events is not going to go away. It's an important one for us, very important for both projection and image processing equipment. We spend a lot of our R&D effort in making sure that we've got products that really fit that market. And it's a very key market. So it's about being able to bring content to life, being able to make it the equipment very easy and fast to set up, because our partners have less and less time when they go into these venues to set up these events. Of course, it's about the return on investment that our partners make. So they buy our equipment and then rent it out to these different events. So they need to make a return on that investment that they make. And of course, it needs to be reliable. The show has to go on. You know, when these screens light up, whatever kind of event, you can't be having black screens. So the equipment has to be ultimately very reliable and bring that peace of mind to the owners. So that's events. A next big bucket is theme parks or themed entertainment, as we sometimes call it. So it's all about those visitor attractions. So more and more in theme parks these days, people are spending less on making roller coasters and these big thrill rides because A, they're very expensive, but B, occasionally they're quite dangerous. There have been accidents in the past, and it becomes more and more difficult to get insurance and things like that. So if you can create those same kinds of wow experiences in what we call dark rides, so typically it's some sort of black box, a building, whereby there'll be probably a motion platform with some seating in, where the ride visitors will come through, they'll take their seats and they'll get taken on a kind of virtual roller coaster ride or simulated experience through space or through a jungle, or, you know, your imagination can run riot here. But still, it's about creating that wow factor. We can do that very safely. We can handle a great many number of visitors because it's very easy to repeat these kinds of attractions within a theme park. So you can maybe have four or five or six of these rides all in one single space and get a great number of people through. So you cut down on the queuing time. And it's a very popular way of creating the wow in theme parks today. And you can recreate that branding as well back to maybe a movie, because a lot of theme parks, of course, are owned by movie studios. So you can continue that branding and theme from the movie all the way through the theme park. Here it's about being realistically recreating that content. These studios, these theme park owners spend a great deal of money on creating the content. And of course, the projectors or the visualization equipment has to very authentically reproduce that content as it was originally intended. So really making eye-popping content. Again, about peace of mind, it has to continue working. It works for a great many hours during the day, lots of days per year. So that has to go. And of course, it has to be cost-effective. You have to be able to maintain it very cost-effectively, very easily on site. You can't afford to have equipment go down. So that's very important. So for us, this is mostly about projection. LED is creeping into this as well. So LED is not completely out of that, but not so much in image processing gear. It tends to be done with media servers together with projectors.
Got it. And the museum space has always like been a huge space for projection, just because the buildings are typically old. You can't really, you know, they're hard to manage around, and projection really is a great feature or technology for the museum space.
Yep, absolutely. For museums, and it's growing in popularity as well. Yep. As museums are trying to go more digital, so that they can share artworks around the world. So maybe you can experience a piece of art in a different city to which that original painting or whatever it is located. So being able to do these things digitally is very important. Being able to take these exhibits and these tours and tour them around the world to different places is more and more important. So that's the key there. And here we're talking about sort of projection, image processing, LED, LCD, all different types of technologies, but with the same kind of view. Again, creating the experience, making it cost effective, bringing that peace of mind to the owners of the installation.
Absolutely. And mapping really is you know, you guys do this in Europe a lot, these big projection maps, you know, pieces of architecture, which is amazing and hard to do, but really, really impressive.
Yeah. And mapping, I mean, I put it as a bucket here. Actually, this can appear in all of these different spaces as a separate item, right? So it's not really a segment all by itself, but I included it here because it is very important and it is being used more and more. As you said, it depends a little bit on geographics as well. So some countries tend to do it more than the others. So for example, here in Europe, the French absolutely love it. They map onto all of their old buildings and monuments all over the place. They absolutely love it. Can't get enough of it. China as well. They go mad for it. They're creating what they call this the nighttime experience economy. So getting people safely into different cities, getting them to tour around the country to spend their vacation dollars at these different experiences and give them something to look at. Whilst they've got this mapping going on, they can keep the shops open a little bit longer. People will go in and spend money. It really creates a destination. And there's been quite a few reference cases of cities showing that creating these mapping festivals at certain times of the year can really drive revenue in the economy of the city. So once they get going on it, then it's they have to keep it going because people come to expect it. And then the hotels, restaurants, shops can't do without it. So for us, it's a very important part of the whole business and something which is growing and clearly very important for projection and image processing.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's something that kind of pays for itself over time. So the ROI for the end user is actually quite good in this particular scenario. Yep. And last but not least is the corporate space, right? And the corporate spaces, you know, we have the collaboration technologies that we offer here at Barco with respect to ClickShare and ClickShare Conference. But there's a lot of corporate spaces that are big where, you know, standard TVs or standard flat panel displays don't really cut the, you know, make it happen for that corporate buyer.
Absolutely. We shouldn't forget the corporate space. It is big. Of course, projection is taking a bit of a beating recently, you know, from all of these LCD displays going into all of these huddle rooms and meeting rooms and everything. But there is still a place for projection in a lot of corporate buildings. So it might not be every single meeting room these days, whereas it maybe was a few years ago. But certainly in the main boardroom where you've maybe got a rather large installation. It could be a lecture theater. Happens a lot in education environments as well, those big theaters where you want to get a message across to many people at the same time. A projector still has a role to play, together, of course, with the other equipment there, particularly with image processing type equipment. So where we're managing all those different sources, bringing them together and composting them together onto the large screen in a very easy and efficient way. But yeah, corporate is indeed the sort of main, one of those main buckets that we do still concentrate on.
All right. Well, so we've got some big application sets here that really vary quite a bit. And it really requires, you know, it makes your life difficult because we have to have a pretty wide assortment of product technologies that to fulfill the unique, you know, application sets that you've identified for us.
Absolutely. In fact, you know, sometimes when we have meetings with our own supply chain people internally, of course, they all want just one SKU and they want zero stock. And then when we come to them and tell them that, look, we need another projector that does something a little bit different from the other projector, then, you know, they start pulling their hair out. But the fact of the matter is that, yeah, you do need quite a range to fulfill all of these different types of applications and experiences. And what we try to do, although, of course, we always try to keep the range as slim as possible to keep those supply chain people happy, we do need quite a range. So Actually, in Barco, we've got a very, very large, wide range. We go from 2,000 to 75,000 lumens. We've got a mixture of single chip DLP and 3DLP. We don't do LCD projectors as some of our competitors do. We find that a very difficult market to compete in. So we'll leave that up to some of the others out there. We do still have one lamp projector in our range still, which is powered by lamps, but there are less and less of them. It's the F50. It's the one on the very far left of the picture that you can see there. But now all of the other projectors are powered by either LEDs or laser. Mm-hmm. And we've got both laser phosphor and laser RGB projectors, so two different types of laser technology as well. So it's not just one, and then all different kinds of resolutions as well. So it's quite a range when you see it all out there.
Yep. Well, and this is where it is, right? So this is the projection lineup today. I think the brand in general has really been well known for this three chip DLP platforms. Especially in the U.S. market, the UDX has been kind of a mainstay platform. The UDM was a new ad for us in 2020, and it's really done quite well in that three-chip market. Where do you see, a lot of our audience may be familiar with the UDX, but they may not be quite as familiar with the UDM. So what was the thought process around bringing that product to market, and what does it provide for our integration partners?
Yeah. So if you look a bit historically here, we used to have the HDX, which was the lamp-based version of that projector a few years ago. We were very successful with it. A lot of our partners, thank you, all bought into that platform. And at that moment, when things were starting to go laser, we chose to invest first in the UDX range, which is why we brought that in 2017. So we had UDX together with the HDX at the time, which was a sort of 20,000 lumen platform, but then, as I said, powered with a lamp. Unfortunately, we weren't able to invest in everything at the same time, so we were actually a little bit late in replacing that HDX with the UDM. The UDM is the successor to that platform. It's the 20,000 lumen laser platform that goes alongside its big brother, the UDX. So now we've got a full range of laser projectors in three chip. So as I said, we were a little bit late. We could have done with it maybe 1 or 2 years earlier, to be honest. But that's choices that we make, in where we put our investments. But indeed, it was very well received when we launched it. We started shipping right at the very end of 2019. So it's been about one full year now that we've had this out there. Of course, it's not the best full year to have a new projector platform out there, but nevertheless, it has done well. It's kept its head up there, and we hope that as things get back to normal, then we'll really start to see the benefits of UDM together with the UDX out there with our partners.
That's awesome. Well, I hear it's a lot of our partners have told us it's a fantastic fit for a lot of the markets that we talked about on the previous slides, but. And if you haven't taken a look at it, please check it out on our website. We find that it's been a very cost competitive, but also feature competitive platform in that entry level three chip market. So take a look at that UDM. Now in 2019, we really kind of entered this G60 category, which you'll see on the screen right, just about the middle of the screen, and that really kind of gave us a cost-effective kind of 7,000, 8,000, and 10,000 lumen platform. We've had some really good success and really good feedback on that platform. But the one piece of feedback we've gotten is it's not quite bright enough for some of the applications. So in January we're going to release this G100. So tell us a little bit about that. And I know we have some additional slides to get into detail. But how have you've obviously seen this? What's your impression of this new G100?
It's great. I'm very excited by the G100. As you said, it's the big brother of the G60. So it's still at that sort of value end of our projection portfolio, offering value for money. It doesn't have all of the whiz bang features that some of the other platforms have, for example, like the F80 or the F90, but it does everything very, very well. And what the G100 does is bring us that single chip DLP entry into the 20,000 lumen category. Now, there's been a few projectors out there for a while now from some of our competitors that have been at that level. We've taken a little bit longer to get there. But we believe that we've got the right package for the job. We've got an excellent projector that's got really great cooling inside of it. We've really cracked the cooling question to make sure that it lasts and it does what it's supposed to do. It's got a very strong lens mount in there. It runs at 110 volts. So it does everything that it needs to do in that category that I think some of the other models which are out there available maybe don't quite do.
That's awesome. Well, we're excited about it. I mean, the initial reports have been really good, and I know that our partners have been asking us, at least here in the Americas, for this type of platform for a number of years. So thanks for delivering it, and we're going to give the audience a little bit more detail on the G100 and the release plan and everything just in a little bit. Now all of this, you know, the projection is great, but if you can't manage the signals, then, you know, what do you do? So tell us, you know, hit on the highlights for us on signal management and presentation switchers in our image processing line.
Absolutely. Yeah, it's the other big product group within our division business unit, image processing. So very important. So two main components. So presentation switching and signal management, as you can see here. So in signal management, we've got our Image Pro 4K. That's an amazing box. It's really anything in, anything out. So it does signal conversion, scaling. So you really can sort of, you really can give it anything in and get anything else out. You can either downscale, upscale, and it does it in such a high quality way that it truly is amazing. So, I mean, I've seen people do all kinds of things with this in the past, taking really sort of rough standard definition video signals and upscaling them to HD or beyond, and it really does an amazing job and gets used in a lot of professional applications, gets used a lot by the rental and staging companies. I mean, I've seen rental and staging houses with full racks of these boxes inside them, because when they arrive on site, they just don't know what kind, they just don't know what signal they're going to get from the client. So if you've got one of these boxes in your arsenal, then you can always convert it to something that you know. So it kind of saves you from all kinds of problems. The second part of that is presentation switching. And here you can see sort of two main blocks. So in the middle there, we've got our S3E2, so our Event Master range of boxes. So very, very flexible system. You can expand on these. You can link these boxes together. You can have more inputs, more outputs. So you can start small, maybe on an installation, but in full knowledge that, in knowing that if you were to get more screens, more inputs being thrown at you, whether this be in fixed or rental, you know, controlling LED walls or projectors, it doesn't really matter. You can really grow the system to suit what it is that you need. And you can have backgrounds and layers and all different kinds of transitions between these different inputs coming. You can have a multi-viewer so that the person who's controlling the whole thing can see what's happening on his multi-viewer. You can have the system being controlled by multiple people at the same time. So you really can split this equipment up over your installation and really maximize the use that you're getting out of it. So it's a very, very popular system, as I said, in both fixed install and in rental and staging. And then lastly, to a smaller scale, our newly launched PDS 4K. So this is the successor to the previous PDS products that we had. We're now going into 4K and a very, very cost-effective, flexible presentation switcher that you can use on a lot in many, many different kinds of applications. So we've got great hopes for this as we go into the new year.
That's great. So, and this is all product that can be used for, you know, other types of display technologies. It's not really, you know, it's not, you know, just for projection, as Richard mentioned. It can fit behind anyone's LED wall, anyone else's LCD wall. It's vendor agnostic, and it really doesn't matter what the input or what the output is. We can pretty much make your space function the way that you want it to and make your content look fantastic. So don't forget about that when you're evaluating kind of building out systems. Look to Barco for some of those image processing solutions that we've talked about. Now let's get into a little bit of information, because I think it is as relevant as around this G100. So 16, 19, and 22,000 lumens, that's pretty bright.
That's pretty bright for a single chip projector. You know, just a few years ago, you know, even getting to 20,000 lumens on a three chip was, you know, was a big thing. So to be able to do that these days on single chip, it really is a big thing. And it's only thanks to the advances that have been made in laser light sources and also in cooling. So being able to light them up and then keep them cool at the same time is what it's all about. So yeah, we're pushing the boundary the whole time to make these things perform better and better.
That's fantastic. And a wide array of inputs.
A wide array of inputs and all the modern inputs. So as you can see here, it's got HDMI 2.0. So that allows you to go for those very wide, high color palettes, 10 and 12 bit color palettes, and also allows you to go to 4K video up to 60 frames. So very useful. Of course, if you've only got HDMI 1.4, then you can't do that. You're stuck at 8 bit color, and you're stuck at 24 or 30 frames per second on 4K. So I think that's rather essential, and certainly something to look out for when you're specking this kind of projector.
Okay, and you do have compatibility with all of the major control room, the control systems that are out there today.
Absolutely, yep. We've got our own what we call projector toolset control, which we can use and allows people to set things up, but no problem to link to all the other control systems which are out there as well.
That's awesome. So that really makes it really easy and flexible to build solutions. So another nice benefit there that that our product team has delivered. Now, what about the size of this thing? Is it doesn't look to be too big. Looks like a big square.
It's a big square box. So it is actually, if you compare it to some of the other models out there, it is a wee bit bigger than some of those traditional competitors. I'm sure everybody knows who I'm talking about out there. It's a wee bit bigger. But what we've done is we've made sure that the cooling really does do the job. So one of the specs that you can see here is that it can withstand 122 degrees Fahrenheit ambient. Now, that's really important. When you put these things in a climate box for an outdoor projection mapping, or you've got it in the roof of a building where you've got thousands of people and, you know, all the heat rises, that's really important to know that this thing is going to continue working even at those very, very high temperatures.
Yeah, that's pretty amazing. And it seems like it's already kind of, you know, rigged and ready to go for fixed installations with some of these mounting points
that
aren't present on the G60.
That's correct. Yeah. So you can see the four holes here on the top in the corners. You can screw directly into those. It's the same story on the bottom. There's some standard mounting holes on the bottoms. We can give you drawings if anybody should need them. But yeah, very easy to get this thing installed and rigged. Of course, with it being laser, you can orient it in any direction. Doesn't matter. Whatever you want to do with it, you can do with it.
That's fantastic. That's great. So that is the box, and it's coming out, and it comes out in January, as we've talked about. So that's great. And so give us a rundown on the lineup between the three models here.
Yep. So it goes into full production in January. So I expect that we'll be in a position to start delivering to partners end of January, early February, I would think, if all goes well. Of course, you never know what might happen. As you mentioned, three different models, hopefully covering that range and allowing the different options. They're all priced accordingly, of course, to allow different budgets to take them. So a 16, a 19, and a 22. Depending on what's needed, they're all WUXGA resolution, so 1920x1200. That's a 1610 aspect ratio. As you see, there's two different weights, so either 110 pounds for the two lower versions or 119 pounds for the slightly brighter one. Very interestingly here, we've got a very full range of lenses. So we go all the way down to 0.38 on an ultra short throw. That can be, that's still with a huge amount of lens shift and with no offset as well. And then we go all the way from 0.65 up to 10.8. There is a very small gap there right down at the bottom. But certainly we go from 0.84 up to 10.8, which is quite long actually, in a lens range. So it should be fairly easy to install. And then the other one at the very bottom there, you see the noise level. It's a bit dependent on mode. So the 36 dBA is for the W16 in eco mode, and the 42 dBA is for the W22 in full power mode. So we go from 36 to 42, everything in between. That's pretty quiet. If you compare that to the other models which are out there, that's considerably quieter, and I think will be noticeable in a lot of rooms. So if it's a meeting room or some sort of corporate or education establishment, that will be noticeable.
Fantastic. And then all of these are 3D capable as well. So we made the call to make them all 3D compatible and support that those types of outputs.
They do. Yep. Absolutely.
That's fantastic. So we've talked a lot about different types of applications, but these are really some of the ones that we see this product and really the whole range really fitting into. And one of the ones that I've seen, you know, quite a bit of recently is really this kind of immersive, kind of experiential type of situation. I know we did a ton of those in Europe, and now we're starting to see quite a number of these kind of pop up in the US. What makes our projection kind of lineup, you know, kind of perfectly designed for, you know, a wide range of applications that we see out in the market?
Yeah, you're right. They are becoming more and more popular. So it's about the colors. At Barco, we always spend a bit of time on making sure that the colors are as good as we can possibly get them. So that when a customer plugs his content into the projector, we realistically reproduce that onto the screen. And we do set ourselves very high levels of making sure that we continue to do that. So that's appreciated by these customers. I think the other thing is the reliability, the lifetime of these products. Whenever we spec projectors, we're very clear about the brightness levels. We quote always ISO lumens, ANSI lumens, center lumens. We don't play smoke and mirrors with brightness specs on spec sheets. And same thing with lifetime as well. Whenever we quote a lifetime of a projector, it's at when the projector is being used at full power. So there are a few people out there who play games with lifetime values, and you have to put the projector in a particular settings to be able to get that particular lifetime. We don't do that. So you know that if you're getting the projector, you can run it at full power and you will get that lifetime. Otherwise you can call us. And of course, if you underrun it, if you choose to run it in a different mode, then of course the lifetime will go up. It will not go down. So I think that's also appreciated by these kind of customers, because obviously if you're making an investment of this nature, then you want the thing to be installed for at least, I would say, 5 to 7 years. That's typically what these investments are made upon. And you want equipment that's going to last that long.
That's awesome. Well, thanks for your insights. So, and one thing that's coming up on January 19th, we'll be sharing information with our channel community through our Connect newsletter that goes out every month. If you're not subscribed to the Connect newsletter, please email us at us.connect@barco.com, and we'll be happy to sign you up for our Connect newsletter, which shares all types of, you know, useful insights and sales programs and upcoming webinars and new product releases. But we've got this webinar that's coming up on the 19th, And this is your opportunity really to go into a deep dive on the G100. We will be taping that, and we'll hold that content so that our partners can see that later on. But look out for that in the following in the follow-up messages coming out from today's session. Now, the last thing is kind of relates very closely to projection, because when I did talk to our help desk team, they said, hey, we get a lot of questions about lensing and trying to understand exactly which lens they should be using. So we have this great tool, and I've thrown the URL up into the corner of the slide here, but you can go on and take a look at any legacy projector that we've ever made. You know, almost I think everything is up there and everything that's current today. And it gives you the opportunity really to design your system with respect to your screen size, the screen ratio, how much, you know, the width and depth of that screen, how far you're going to be away from the screen itself, how many projectors are you going to stack, so you're creating that blending. And it will also kind of give you an opportunity to pick the appropriate lens for each one of those applications and your specific room, so that you can then, you know, make sure that you're speccing the right solution. And at the end, it gives you this whole nice kind of, you know, technical printout that you can then include in your design layout and drawings, so that you know exactly what you're getting with the system that you have selected within that lens calculator. So this applies to all of our products, and it's the same link for each one of the solutions that we offer out in the market. So as you're starting to look at some of the different application sets that we've talked about today, the events, the theme parks, museums, mapping, and corporate, and one other one that I would throw in here would be the arena market, doing some of that floor mapping and ice mapping that we always see on many of the professional indoor sports, NBA, NHL, et cetera. You know, this gives you the confidence that you can lay out your solution, lay out your space, select the right product for the right application, and really make sure that you're selecting the right components to build that solution. And don't forget that the pre-sales engineering team, again, is always available for consultation and help when you are building solutions. And it's a resource that we urge you to take advantage of. Now, we always end PartnerCast with the five things to remember. So the first one is Connect partners always have full access to our pre-sales engineering team located around the U.S. And they all have different specialties, but we'll always find somebody to help you. Our projection platforms offer flexibility to match the product and capabilities based on your customer's unique environments. Our new G100 platform becomes available to U.S. partners in January 21. And that really should say America's partners, because we'll have all the regulatory approvals already in place when that product is released. Connectivity is really critical. So look at our image processing platforms when you're looking to manage complex signal flows and build really amazing experiences for your partners. And last but not least, we win and lose with our partners in the Americas region. We're 100% channel-based organization. We always have a partner engaged in every commercial transaction that we enter into throughout the Americas market. And we really win or lose with you. We don't do direct sales, and you're not going to lose a sale direct to Barco. So those are really key things to remember. And that really wraps up our content today on our December PartnerCast. And Estella, if you'll come off mute, did we get any questions in the Q&A box that we should address real quickly before we wrap it up?
Sure, I have a couple of questions. They wanted to know about deal registration programs.
So we do offer deal registration programs for all of our Connect partners, and it really goes across the entire product line. That is, you know, driven through our My Barco platform. If you don't have a My Barco account, that's your insider information for all of our partners to get access to all of the great tools, but also access all of our sales incentive programs. So if you don't have a My Barco account, please connect with us at us.connectedbarco.com. We do offer standard deal registration programs across the entire projection portfolio and image processing portfolio, but all of the other solutions that we offer at Barco as well.
And the final question was, how can I get training from Barco?
That's another great question. You know, beyond our pre-sales engineering, the consulting work that we do with our partners, we also have a full suite of educational courses that are on demand available again through that My Barco portal. We have a My Barco University link, which lists out all of the classes. And in 2021, we're really going to add a lot more classes specific on image processing and projection. And a lot of that content today is available on demand. So check out the Barco University site. You'll see all of the courses that are available to our partners in the Americas. And sign up today for a My Barco account, because that's going to be the best way for you to gain access to all of this very, very valuable information for our partner community.
And that's
anything else, Estella?
Nope, that was it.
All right, sounds great. Well, Richard, thank you for joining today, and we really appreciate your insights. And wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday. For all of our partners out there that joined today, thank you again for joining. Remember, PartnerCast is a monthly session that we host to share insights with our partners. And please look out for the future announcements on next month's PartnerCast in January. We'll really be talking about dealer programs and our strategy for 2021. So thanks again. Happy holidays, and hope you have a great afternoon.
Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas, Richard.